All right, thank you. So this presentation is about the interesting question of what kind of frameworks, tools, and solutions we should be expecting for producing free-to-play games in the future. Or if you look from the other hand, should the game developers actually build their own solutions rather than using external ones? And we'll find answers for these questions today in a fun and interactive crowdsourcing exercise, so you will all be participating in this session. Really looking forward to that. The reason why we're all in this room is that free-to-play has proven to be a fantastic monetization model for games. But a lot of the innovation is still happening like inside the individual gaming studios or custom-made build for individual game applications, and not that much yet on the sort of framework or solution or tool side. And one reason for that is that free-to-play is still fairly new, and it takes some time for tools and platforms to catch up. So this is a picture of me making whipped cream with a power drill. Okay. The picture was taken around the time when we were moving and stuff was in the boxes and I had to improvise. We got the cake done and yeah, things worked. Definitely wasn't the best tool for this purpose. Got the job done, you know, spinning speed wasn't right. Took too long time to make the whipped cream. It was too heavy, not the safest option. I possibly got some concrete mix dust in my whipped cream, but anyway, got the job done. So what am I trying to say? I'm trying to say that don't use power drills for making free-to-play games. That's exactly what I'm saying. But I'm also saying that a lot of the tools that we are using for free-to-play games, they are still fairly generic, and I would claim that we would add much more value for the game developers as publishers, tool developers, and platform makers if we would do things optimized for free-to-play. So if you think from the game developer's perspective, so when you are selling your game in a store, you need the store, which is in principle, it's a distribution and payment solution. But that's not all. You need to think about what other things around that sort of core offer you need to use. So there's ad networks, reward solutions, monetizing solutions, social gaming solutions. You need to decide as a game developer, am I going to use those or not? Are they going to help me in selling my game? But also I need to make a decision as a game developer, should I even use external solutions, should I build them on their own? And that's actually the specific question we will be now finding answers for next. And I made a game for you. This is a gaming event, so I thought we should be playing some games. It's probably not the most original game title. You might have seen something similar somewhere, but it'll get us some answers. And the name of the game that we will now play together is Who Wants to Be a Free-to-Play Millionaire? Okay, how the game works is that I will be presenting one topic related to creating free-to-play games, and then I will be presenting a couple of options, and you need to then vote by raising your hand which do you think is a right answer, and in the end we'll all get wiser, and we talk about the right answers in the end. Okay? How many of you are game developers in the room? Okay, hands down. How many are tool providers or tool creators? Okay, so the rest you need to imagine if you're a game developer or tool provider, because these questions are set up in a way for that audience. First topic is analytics. That covers anything, you know, business intelligence, any databases, SDKs, whatever hooks you put to the games to get data from the user. Use that data for iterating game loop and monetization loop, acquisition funnel data, and so on. So there's definitely a lot of analytics tools available, but I think they are still fairly generic. And why I'm saying that, because a lot of the free-to-play games, especially if you go to one specific genre, there are several things that you want to track, actually the same things you want to track across games. There's tutorial completes, quest completes, and all that. And I've been in several presentations here, and I hear people giving good advice, like what to track and how to track and all that. I think in a good tool that is optimized for free-to-play, you can actually put a lot of the intelligence inside the tool. You don't need to build that specifically for one game. Actually, I would compare to social gaming solutions. There's been social gaming SDKs on mobile for 10 years, actually exactly 9 years. And they, you know, they have features like leaderboards, friends list, and all that. You don't need to build those from the scratch. And I think on analytics, we could find more free-to-play optimized things that do the work for us. So the first question is related to analytics. Which of these statements is most true? Good BI tools are must and should be built in-house is option A. Option B, Good BI tools are must and should be external dedicated solutions. Who thinks option A is the right answer? Please raise your hand. No two hands got, so let's say 8 people. Okay, hands down. Who thinks option B is the right answer? I would say 17. All right. And now for those people who didn't raise your hand, I'm putting words to your mouth. So your option is analytics for wimps and amateurs. It's great to have such professionals in the room who know better without analytics. You see what I'm doing? I'm trying to make you be more interactive. So if you don't raise your hand, I'm going to tell what you think. Next topic is performance marketing. So there's definitely user acquisition agencies, ad networks available there to do the paid advertising. There's a lot of skill involved, and especially for free-to-play, you need to find the right kind of people. So you need to personalize ads for specific segments. And this is not that much of a solution, but it's more a skill, and I think there are specific skills for doing performance marketing for free-to-play. Let's jump to the next question, which is, again, which of these statements is most true? A, developers should learn to use user acquisition in-house. Option B, using publisher or user acquisition agency gets the best results. Who thinks option A is the right answer? That's 32. Okay, option B, who thinks option B is the right answer? I have 7, thank you. Option C, for the rest of you, everyone will know my game is super, why should I pay for marketing? That's actually not even a joke, a lot of indie developers have to rely on that. Especially if they have one game which is successful, they cross-promote people out from there. So option C might be a valid option here. Next topic is actually cross-promotion, I just mentioned. So you, with cross-promotion, you leverage the network effect. So if you got a portfolio of games inside the gaming studio, naturally you want to make those players, when they play their next game, you want them to play your game rather than someone else's. If you work with a publisher, there's a benefit of cross-promoting between the games inside the publisher. If you use any link exchange solution, same kind of thing. But here, I think there's a lot of cross-promotion solutions already, but I would say that we are not using them the best way at all, and I think it's either the tools are not easy to use or they are not good enough or something. Like a lot of the games what I play, the first thing what I, you know, when I install a game, the first thing what I see is interstitials trying to push me to play another game. I think that's definitely not the right thing. I maybe could have paid for that game. And then there's naturally a lot of information. Am I a payer? Am I a non-payer? You treat them differently. If there's intelligence to find out that this person who was a payer is about to quit, that could be a best moment to do cross-promotion. Okay, which of these statements is most true? A, players should be cross-promoted only between developers' own games. Option B, opening to wider cross-promotion network gets more business in the end. Option A, who thinks that's right? 5 people. Option B, who thinks option B is the right answer? That's 47. And option C for you guys is, my player should not play anything else ever. Service operations, content updates and events drives naturally game lifecycle. I can't emphasize how important service operations are free-to-play games. We got one game in Kaban that was running for, you know, fourth year and, you know, still making great money. So now the question, this is actually quite tricky. So there's a lot of game-specific things that you want to, can you even make this as a service or product? But then if you think about, like, one of the trends what I've seen at GDC especially was that a lot of companies with successful games, they are thinking about how can I extend to other regions that I haven't been selling my games before. And then you face the question, what do I need to do for the game to make that succeed in the other markets? But if I do any service operations there, it's definitely going to be different than what I'm used to in my region. So then there's a good question of should there be someone else doing that for you, or should you really learn those skills? The questions for service operations, which of these statements is most true? A, service operations is very game-specific and cannot be externalized. Option B, externalizing service operation frees resources from new game for new game creation. So who thinks option A is the right answer? 24. Option B, who thinks option B is the right answer? That's 7.5. And option C is how my game was launch ready. I don't need to update that at all. Social gaming, my favorite topic. I'm saying that Xbox Live concept is still the de facto. What I mean by that is that a lot of the, there's been social gaming SDKs for a long time, even for mobile, but still the feature set is quite same what it has been from the launch of Xbox Live, and it, which means that was a fantastic concept. But then I would raise the question, if it's something that was designed for consoles and paid games, should we see the same feature set on mobile for free-to-play games? One example here, leaderboards. So leaderboards are usually based on high scores. How many free-to-play games you have with high scores? So could there be something different? And I bet there would be. Question for the social gaming. Which of these statements is most true? A, integrating with current social network, read Facebook or Google Plus or whatever other socials that are available. Features is all I need. Option B, new free-to-play optimized solutions would significantly help. Who thinks option A is the right answer? That's zero. Or is that a half? One, okay. Okay, so then option B, who thinks option B is the right answer? Still not many hands coming up, so but it's still 27, which is pretty good. Okay, so rest, there's a lot of who thinks option C is the right answer. My players play alone, that's true and sad. Next topic, rewards, in-game incentives, cross-game rewards. With incentives, I don't mean incentives to get the people playing another game. I'm actually talking about incentivizing them to do something inside this game. So converting them to be a payer or, you know, doing things. So there's a lot of items for free-to-play games. There's a lot of things you can give for to, you know, incentivize people. But then, of course, there's like airlines and casinos. They have loyalty programs. So some generic system that works, you know, across games. You know, yeah, what should happen for free-to-play games here? Question, which of these statements is most true? A, there are enough incentivization options with in-game currency and items. Option B, ready-made reward solution would boost sales and save effort. Option A, how many votes do we get for option A? Six. Option B, who thinks option B is the right answer? That's 16. Okay. Option C, I don't believe in discounts, neither did my grandmother. I don't know what she was selling, but I don't think she was selling speed-ups. Next, messaging and chat. Success of Kakao and Facebook as a game discovery network. I mean, social networks, there's a lot of other stuff going on than just messaging and communication. But that's one key feature. And some of the games, they have in-game chat, especially on web, but still also on mobile. So what is the role of messaging and chat? Like for free-to-play games specifically, there's a lot of people who don't pay and never pay. Could we use the sort of communication or messaging or, you know, generated by these people to make the game more fun for the paying? Question, which of these statements is most true? A, messaging should be limited to in-game. Option B, gamers should have ways to be connected across games to the gaming community. Who thinks option A is the right answer? In-game chat gets five votes. And option B, that's quite a lot. That's actually 23. Then option C is not needed as my players have an email account. They can send messages to each other when they want. Monetization solutions, that's actually quite wide topic. I'll take some examples of that. So of course you can do monetization with in-app payments. But because of how the store work right now, you need to enter each item to the store, and that doesn't allow too much flexibility. And probably because of that, I see a lot of fixed paywalls. So every single person sees the same paywall, even if you're a whale or even if you're a person who hasn't paid, you still see the same items. If we could have more intelligence for there, we could probably promote the right items. And you know, this could be an external solution actually just for this purpose, simplifying the complexity of working with the stores and so on. Showing, using the information of showing the paywall in the right moments, that's another piece that I think would definitely pay out. But should that be done in-house or externally? Which of these statements is most true for monetization solutions? A, monetization is too game-specific to benefit from external solutions. Option B, good platform solutions would definitely help. Option A, how many votes? One. Option B, how many votes? 30. And option C, paying is overrated, it's free to play, right? And that was the last question in our game of who wants to be a free-to-play millionaire. I think we all learned a lot, like what kind of things we should be expecting, what kind of things would add more value for the free-to-play game developer. I definitely have my own opinions or own views, what are the right answers. I'm happy to share them after the presentation. Find me from somewhere, buy me a beer, and I'll tell you more than you want to know about the right answers. But those people who selected the actual right answers, which the business reality will soon confirm to be the right answers, I'm sure you are already on your way to become free-to-play millionaires. Thank you.
Any questions?
So you keep referring to this social mobile gaming network of 9 years ago. To which are you referring?
That's two beers.
You're not going to tell us what the name of that
is? I'll tell you in the bar with two beers. Next question.
Really? Really? Seriously, dude?
Get the mic from Scott. Next question.
So it's kind of like a free-to-play game. You got to give them two beers to get to the next level. Who's next? Anyone?
So in terms of cross-promotion specifically, like right now the obvious tools like for cross-platform cross-promotion within your game is using something like Playhaven. And you know, they offer the typical like more games button that gives you, you know, the list, and then just interstitials with, you know, either pre-game or in-game interstitial advertising, and of course, I guess there's banner options.
Yeah.
Is there anything else? Like, what's the best way to cross-promote within your own network to your games?
I think the key question is like when to cross-promote. I think I think there's definitely a lot of ways already. Like, you know, you have interstitials, you have, you know, I think just adding intelligence. What is the right moment to cross-promote? I think that's the key question, and that's what I see mostly going wrong. So it's about getting the data and actually finding the right indicators. Like, how do you even tell that somebody's about to stop playing the game when that person is still in the game? Yeah.
Great, thanks. Nicole Lazaro from Zio Design. What in terms of monetization, when is the right moment, following on that question, when is the right moment to, you know, monetize? What's the most effective monetization strategy you've experienced working at Kabam?
Yeah, I'm actually working myself in the platform side team, so not in the studio team, so probably I don't want to give you the wrong answer or reveal the secret sauce what the studio guys are doing on that.
But on a platform side, what would you say the three most features or whatever that should a platform provide if we were to go to a platform provider?
That's one beer question.
You're gonna get drunk.
That's my intention. Looking good.
So out of all of the tools that you listed over here, what does Kabam do in-house versus use external tools for?
I need to go back to the beer answer. So we have a roadmap for, we have our own games in our own studio, and then we have a platform where I'm working, and actually we are working on a roadmap of SDK and actually for web games and mobile games. And there's a lot of the things that they are what we are planning for our roadmap, but we haven't made any releases what's coming for example in our mobile SDK. But I think that what we're trying to do is add value for the game developer, having the right things and making, you know, accelerating developing the games, having helping the game developer not to repeat building the same thing all over for each game. So yes, we definitely will have answers and solutions for that, but I'm not here to reveal what we're planning yet. Okay, thank you.